phrase of Ben's, we're kind of this weird platypus, we're neither fish nor fowl. We are both a public library system, 88 branches across Staten Island, the Bronx, and Manhattan, as well as 4 research centers. So we're serving both the needs of researchers like yourselves, as well as those community information needs. As we all know, the nature of information and sharing information has changed radically, right? The print-based model has moved to a digital networked world. And with this, libraries are constantly sort of re-evaluating our roles. What does it mean to be a library in this day and age? And we are thinking that labs are the place, while many of our colleagues are involved in the reinvention of the library, I think we at Labs have been the place where we have been most actively kind of testing out these new sort of models of library practice and thinking through the implications of like library in the network age. And that's what this doodle is supposed to be illustrating here. So whereas the library has traditionally been this place where everyone comes to get the stuff, the library here is bringing its information, its resources out into a networked context.
So I should just say that we didn't make that. this was a gift from a departing colleague that Ben found on his desk one morning. And he was like, this is it. This is it.
Yeah.
We are the node on the network. We are no longer the one place to basically Victorian model of how you encompass the entire internet in one building. This is turning the place inside out.
Right. So just so you know, that helps with the mental image of, you know, the library as sharing out what it knows and its collections out into the networked universe. Library's knowledge graph, library's API, library is a place to build upon. So that's a little bit about labs conceptually, but concretely what we are is both this kind of R&D investigative unit of a library, as well as now a full-fledged digital library program. So we are responsible for digitizing the library's collections, applying metadata to them, managing the permissions and reproductions of our digital assets, as well as continuing to lead up investigations and R&D in various ways. I think we're going to go into some deep dives on specific projects that we've been involved in. This is a really interesting moment for us to be speaking with you all, because the library is thinking about its future on 2 axes. One is that the library is about to undertake a big renovation in the next couple of years, where the labs, among many other things, the labs program will have the opportunity to be instantiated in space. So we will have a physical place where we're going to be calling it something like NYPL Labs. So I just want to plant that seed in your minds, because I think at the end of this conversation, it'd be really interesting to think about why we are here in a research institute, a lab-like space. What might this look like for our program? We're also in the moment of really kind of working through some growing pains of what our digital organization looks like. And because Labs has sort of focused mostly on digitizing our historical collections, that's been our sort of primary work to date, that doesn't mean that that's where we need to stay. So I would like to be thinking with you all about sort of opening up that purview and where our opportunities are. So I think with that, I will turn it over to Ben to kind of give us an introduction into some of the crowdsourcing projects that we've been involved in, moving our historical collections into digital context. And then we're going to talk about some data and information flows, civic data in particular. Dave's going to take us through that, as well as opening this up into sort of some future cases and future investigations. So with that,
I'm also the guinea pig for the AV capture system, but it's, yeah. Hence, I'm the only one with this, but because I'm the one guinea pig, I guess. So as Shana said, that a lot of our investigations to date, this has been a group that's been evolving very organically in a very constantly changing institutional landscape. And so it started as more of a kind of a small interactive R&D unit, kind of skunk works, looking at and responding to some kind of institutional calls to invest in what's being termed the digital humanities in various contexts, and looking at the library as a materials repository and what those materials can look like in the hands of new kinds of researchers and digital practitioners and what needs to be done to them in order for them to be leverageable in those contexts. And so a lot of the character of our early work has been around those digital collections, and as a result, other units in the library who were working on pieces of that digital lifecycle were eventually brought together, and so we're now one big family working on this together. So it's really, we're in a very like awesome integrative stage around that kind of digitization lifecycle. So what I'm going to walk you through now is a couple examples of projects that we've had running for a couple years that are looking at that. So basically, all in one way or another, asking the question, you know, you've digitized something from the kind of the special collections or research collections, archival collections. Now what? Do you just put it on a web page and expect people to come to it? Is that enough? Can it even be discovered? How do you open it up to new kinds of uses? So we kind of scouted around the library very entrepreneurially and found curators and folks in collections who had interesting ideas about collections, who thought, you know, there are possibilities beyond mere digitization that could be opened up by some more interventions with the material. And also thinking about the library's public mission and this very unusual and kind of wonderful mandate of being a public-facing research library, a research library that has, you know, the caliber of a major academic research library, but doesn't have, strictly speaking, like a faculty or a student body. It's really just facing the world. And what does that mean? And it causes like constant identity crisis, but it also opens up a lot of opportunities to do things that can maybe balance between sort of a scholarly interest and a very popular appeal, and maybe involve the public in some way. And looking at kind of peer-produced internet native resources like Wikipedia, open source software, looking at how can the library be operating in that mold? How can we build resources with the public's, in partnership with the public? Also because we don't have the resources to do some of the things we're imagining, so how can we be wily and sort of bring in kind of a larger distributed kind of collaborator base? So this does get into some of those kind of questions of like ethics and, you know, of kind of crowd labor. So love to get your honest take on what we're doing. So a project that kind of got a lot of this started is this project called What's on the Menu, which is around a really interesting niche archive that the library has of restaurant and banquet menus going back to the mid-19th century. They really tell the story of, you know, the origins of public dining culture, which we all take for granted, restaurants, eating in public. But it was actually kind of a pretty novel thing that kind of emerged in the 19th century and then started to really spread in the 20th century very explosively. And this collection, which is about 45,000 items, which really focuses, its most dense parts are around the late 19th, early 20th century, were collected by kind of a hyper-motivated volunteer who just collected these things on behalf of the library. Her name was Mrs. Frank M. Butolph. I actually don't know what her actual first name was. The patriarchy has remembered her as Frank, by the name of her husband. But she collected these things on behalf of the library and then was given some kind of quasi-official status as a volunteer and a stamp that she could put right in the middle of these menus, unfortunately. And then the collection has grown a little more gradually over the years, right up to the current present day, and it's in our rare books division. But we started kind of hatching this plot with our electronic resources coordinator who manages subscription databases, ProQuest, things like that, but also is a culinary expert and had been kind of stewarding, without an official curatorial division, a lot of the culinary collections in the library and was the go-to person for people asking questions about these menus. And the menu collection is very frequently consulted. It's often surfaced in exhibitions. People look at them as artifacts in themselves, but often people are wanting to kind of ask questions of them, you know, and track information across them. They have sort of data-oriented impulses in response to this collection, but just having it digitized, and only about a quarter of it is digitized, approaching half, doesn't really get you there. You're not able to ask those kinds of questions of the contents of these menus. So typically you would look to like OCR, or automated text extraction methods. For a variety of reasons, these menus don't lend themselves well to OCR. Some of them are okay. A lot of them are handwritten or have very strange idiosyncratic fonts. And then you also have the question of, we really want to look at this as kind of a structured data set, not just kind of scooping words off pages. We want to kind of get instances of dishes and track them across time and look at price fluctuations and things like that. So we really started to think, wow, what could you do with this as a data set if you could get it in that form? And so then we were, again, faced with the question, the reality of, we have no one to do this work. So we said, this could be a really interesting crowdsourcing project. This collection has great popular appeal. What if we can construct a decent interface and invite people to help transcribe these dishes and their economic data, you know, item by item, and see where we get? And so we launched this actually in 2011, and in the spring of 2011, right around this time, actually, around Passover, I remember. Because I remember we launched it and I ran to a Seder. And it, the public, we had about 8,000 or 9,000 menus at that time digitized, and it went through them in a couple months. And then we've been sort of struggling to actually keep up and digitize more, but we've run into resource constraints around needing to catalog and process the collection. So it's sort of slowed down as a public engagement project, but with the public's help, we've built this resource with over 1.3 million transcriptions off of these menus. And then did some work. So I'll show you basically how the mechanic works. As you'll see here, it says help review, not help transcribe. We had to redesign this a little bit to deal with content shortages where we weren't able to keep up with digitization for this project. So, but there's sort of a very, very lightweight workflow where you'll transcribe something, say it's been transcribed, move it into a review column, people keep looking at it, and eventually it'll get marked as done. And I'll show you one that's under review just to give you a sense of the mechanic. You just go to a page here, and in this case, can you all see this? I like blocking it. Try to get away from that. I'll just click one that's been, this is a wine list. I just click one that's already been transcribed and I can edit it, but it would be the same mechanic for a kind of an untouched menu. Just click it, type it, save it. So, and then these things become data that can be you can start to look at across the collection. You can then, you can search anything. I'm going to search Pan Am. We find we have, airline menus. And then each of these dishes can be explored. I'll pick one that has a lot of frequency across the collection, like Sanka. And we built some basic visualization tools. These were designed by Maurizio here. To kind of look at these trends across this collection. Not making a claim that this is Sanka like officially across time, but it's across this collection, which is one of the largest aggregations of historical menus that exists. So it's both an interesting resource for research that could be used right now with some qualifications, and also a provocation of like looking at an archive in a new way. We track the coordinates of where these things appear on the page. Sometimes it tells you something you already know, coffee's at the end of the meal. But you can start to look at these trends across the collection. And we've then opened up that data both as kind of CSV exports and kind of what was actually the library's first publicly documented API around this one collection. And it's been, we get requests every week for tokens to use this API for educational purposes, people from startups, people working on like food apps. And then in a couple cases, some really interesting uses that give us strong encouragement that opening up historical collections this way can really lead to some very kind of transformative possibilities. So on a kind of a very atomic level, there's a great Planet Money story that was sort of in typical fashion looking through the prism of a specific dish, in this case, the filet mignon at Delmonico's, and looking at its price over time, along with other data, kind of like the Bureau of Labor Statistics and things like this, to kind of tell a picture of the socioeconomic situation at a few different times. And, here a very casual consultation, but opening up the collection in that way allowed that kind of very simple query to kind of hone in immediately on some historical information. And then at greater scale, there's a couple of digital humanities scholars, one at the University of Maryland and one at Penn, who are looking at this data set, which is one of the only of its kind, kind of opened up from a niche archive like this, opened up programmatically to practice kind of this emerging work of data curation. Like, how do you look at the data set as a thing to be curated and improved and stewarded? So they're doing a lot of downstream work with this, deduping, clustering, creating data dictionaries, and sort of improving this data set downstream. So a kind of a hunch and a hope we'd had initially was like, we'll put this out there, it'll be a little messy, but it'll already open up the contents more. Maybe others will take this work further. So we've seen that potential already start to be illustrated. And of course, it just sort of opens up the collection. We see, when you look at the kind of Google Analytics, like what are the kind of inbound links to the collection, they're often from search terms that have nothing to do with menu and certainly have nothing to do with library. They're looking for a long shuttered deli in the Lower East Side or a cruise line that they know has some connection to an immigration story in their family, and they find a menu that we have. And so that is interesting and suggestive of how what it means to really truly open up materials like this to the web. So I'll give you another example, and this is the one that we're really kind of now in the present kind of pushing to a next stage. So we also have a lot of maps in the library, and these are kind of endlessly fascinating. And we have almost half a million maps and atlases and cartographic works. And a large subset of that is around New York and New York City. And those are some of the most frequently consulted items in our map division, like in person. Insurance maps, fire insurance maps, Sanborns and the like. People doing architectural history, urban studies, people doing genealogy, people just looking up the value, trying to figure out the value and the history of their home, all kinds of different uses. And we've been particularly fascinated with these insurance maps that because they have, I'll just zoom in here, this is just one example of one plate from an 1857 street atlas. If it will load. We may have a little Wi-Fi issue. There we go. So as you can see, when you get in closer, there's a fantastic level of detail here. It's still rendering the tiles. Individual building footprints, addresses, and all these color codings and hash marks that the map's key will indicate to you mean things about material types, use types of these buildings. So there's a huge amount of data in these images. And digitizing these maps gives you pixels. It gives you images with some metadata. So we're looking at how do we get these maps to basically work like the maps we use today digitally. So this has been the kind of collection category where we've pushed the furthest with that kind of like extending that life cycle. So it starts with geo-rectifying these maps. So this map is part of an entire atlas that has been aligned to coordinates on the Earth and then kind of had non-map parts of the pages cropped away into a new derivative data set. And maybe I'll hazard to download it in a more exciting way to look at Google Earth. These are new kinds of library assets that we're providing. You can just download this from the web page, open it in an environment like Google Earth, and this is the fun effect. And then slam-o, you get like kind of a historical layer right there, and you can start to do some then and now comparisons. So right there, that's a pretty startling remediation of a library collection. With provenance back to the original bibliographic object, which comes from this bibliographic work, but now it's spatial data that you can use and visualize in these environments. That's step one. That's sort of now you have a map canvas that is kind of spatially aware, that a GIS software knows what to do with it. But we want to get all those buildings and all that kind of granular data. So there are tools in this MapWarper project that actually predates our group, was built with some contractors externally, some OpenStreetMap kind of activists. And there are some tools in here for transcribing buildings, basically drawing polygons, transcribing attributes. They're really cumbersome, and we've been trying to open them up to the crowd, to kind of public participants, and it's cripplingly dull and complex work. And even that being said, with some kind of more targeted engagement, like a class project or people coming in for on-site workshops, we've crunched through a bunch of data. So about three atlases have had their entire building layer transcribed. And whatever you think of, like 120, 130,000 shape files. And these are all exported in like, the kind of canonical GIS formats. But there's a real bottleneck that we're looking at there. Warping the maps, not so much, but getting those buildings, just kind of unimaginable. So we've started to play with automated methods, kind of like analogous to OCR. See, what can we train computers to read off these maps at a kind of quick pass? And so Maurizio here has developed an amazing kind of imaging workflow that detects these polygons and spits out shapefiles, which are pretty accurate. And sort of analogous to the accuracy you might get from a text extraction OCR process. So then this opens up new possibilities for crowdsourcing, breaking things into smaller tasks that are a little more fun, a little more enjoyable, that might get some more scale participation. So that's what we've been doing with our building inspector project, which is already kind of positioned rather differently as a kind of a casual participatory engagement, kill time, make history. And you've got these four, soon to be five, tasks, data extraction and data cleaning tasks that we've broken apart into very bite-sized interactions. And so this just infographic explains what they are. Initially, it's just asking you, did the computer identify this building correctly? Or is it not even a building? Or is it kind of a building but needs fixing? This is a terrible example because it'll take me forever to fix. I'm just going to skip it. When this loads. So this is a building that's been kind of the community has agreed needs to be fixed. Three or more people have classified it the same way, and it's gone through a consensus queue into a new task, and I can now, right here, I'm going to actually do it, bear with me, can fix this. And, oh, no, I don't need that at all. to do this. There we go. But you can see it's quite easy. And it actually works surprisingly. I'm going to get rid of these extraneous markers and show you how this also works really nicely in a mobile form factor. Sorry. Yeah. Wait, where's the corner? Oh my God. Yeah, here we go. So this is going to get crazy. Okay, but you see how we're really getting tapping into the energies, the obsessive compulsive energies of our community. And there we go. Wow, that was like really high pressure, high stakes data cleaning. So there we go. And I'll shrink this down to show you just the, we're proud of the interface work we've done here. Like, you know, this is, we're trying to put out things too that you wouldn't necessarily expect to come out of a library. Make that. So that works nicely in a phone. You still have to be connected to the internet. I'm going to save that. Okay, so after that punishing demo, where the hell is this going? Why? I mean, yeah, it's like you start to get really like obsessed and like drawn into the map, and it's all really cool, but like why the hell are we doing this? So with some of the building data and map data we have mined so far, we've already started to observe some really interesting uses. Bring these up. Oops. So after Hurricane Sandy, and this is not about the building level as much, but we were contacted by the governor's office wanting to basically get a bunch of rectified maps from us that illustrated the man-made expansion of the lower Manhattan shoreline to show how we had actually made the city incredibly vulnerable to storm surges and kind of other effects of climate change. And let me bring this up. And this is just a kind of a extract from a report that shows you how the shoreline has grown in these kind of big these big bursts. And all these areas, I believe the blue areas were flooded. And then these orange ones were actually totally tracked to the original marsh ponds that were part of Manhattan. Anyway, so but just how historical materials when opened up to computational analytical environments can really inform public debates about the present of cities, the future of cities. So this is one of those examples where we're like, wow, this stuff has a very here and now impact. And there's a lot of people doing research looking at these insurance maps to look at the environmental footprint left behind by past industries on present properties and things like that. And another really wonderful example, I'll leave you with this one. Where's cholera map? I guess this is easier said than done. So this is, Sonia Shaw is a kind of a science journalist who's actually publishing a book, I think later this year, on epidemics. And she was spending a lot of time in the map division looking at our historical maps around the cholera outbreak of 1832 in New York City, kind of in anticipating the ghost map kind of methodology, demonstrated how these things had come from water sources and was able to basically replay in this kind of interactive journalistic format the outbreak. So this is actually, it's using map data from an 1854 street atlas. So it's sort of the most proximate we have right now to the time period of the outbreak. Let me just get a little closer here. So then you can start to replay these fatalities.
And this
it's
is
pretty grim.
Because for a lot of the addresses that were listed in doctor's logs of who had died of cholera, those addresses changed between then and now. Entire neighborhoods bulldozed, particularly down by where the Brooklyn Bridge, Manhattan Bridge are now. Streets reassigned, new buildings built. And so in order to actually get this kind of accurate picture, they needed some sort of ground truth. And the mapping data that was generated by hand for all these buildings in Manhattan was what they were able to use to accurately place these people at the correct place in that time.
Right.
You throw it against the Google geocoder today,
right,
it won't get you that. It'll throw someone in the St. Lawrence Seaway.
So you see a lot of popular apps kind of saying, hey, let's map the past. Let's like kind of bring old photos and put them on a map. And it's great. And I think speaking to that impulse, we want to be able to access historical material through the kind of information-seeking tools and environments that we use today. Like, why should that be relegated to physical archives or kind of like kind of crappy library interfaces like catalogs that really have need to kind of be dusted off and re-examined from an interface perspective, from a data perspective. So we see the maps as a particularly vivid kind of an arena to be exploring how we can bring the information about the past and about this city into kind of a contemporary information context. And so, emboldened by some of these experiments, we are just received funding from the Knight Foundation as part of their recent Knight News Challenge to take this to the next level. And we're going to be building something that we call the New York City Space-Time Directory.
This is not audaciously named.
Yeah, very sober-minded project. And to kind of basically accelerate the data mining of these maps and build it into a kind of a comprehensive georeferencing framework and mapping environment for historical New York, just that. And then also start to associate other heritage collections and data from our institution and others through this map. So photos, old photos, an obvious place to start to kind of both to kind of cater to popular appeal and also show the possibilities and sort of model some of the kind of linking structures we need. Also things like city directories, which are basically the precursor to phone books. We have, going back to the late 18th century, annual runs, full runs of city and business directories. So these are residential directories, all the people who lived in New York, their addresses, often their professions, and listings of businesses and commercial entities. So they're basically databases in paper form. They're basically CSVs that we need to kind of digitize, OCR, structure, and then map and train geocoders that can be historically aware and tied to those kind of building hooks that we're extracting through these kind of crowdsourcing workflows. So rather audacious. We have about 2.5 years to kind of get a working kind of public model of this together. And the idea here too, and this gestures back to what Shana was talking about with the kind of the engagement function and the kind of program we're trying to build, the kind of bridging function Labs is trying to play to new publics, new kind of practitioners for the library, is to not only do this with the public's help in the sense of the crowdsourcing, this kind of distributed tasks and data indexing and cleaning, but putting a call out to the tech community here, saying, hey, who wants to work on a really interesting side project? And sort of start to organize challenges and kind of brigades and like working groups that could address pieces of this platform. So that's something, how we actually do that is something we're figuring out now. But when we put this call out when the grant was announced earlier this year, we got with this kind of crazy website that was like, we're gonna do this crazy thing. A lot of emails came in, dozens and dozens of people saying, hey, I'm a developer, I have a computer vision background, I'd like to help. And so we've started a forum going with some basic discussion, kind of setting the stage a bit, and we're gonna hire, we have the funds to hire one new developer to our core team, and expect this to be ramping up a lot in the coming year. So that's where it's going. We're putting a big stake down in historical geography, historical GIS in the New York urban context with that level of density and granularity, and seeing how it can serve as a new kind of framework for exposing historical material. So we're also thinking about the possibilities of data mining newspapers and other things like that, and other scholarly data sets. We're constantly meeting people who have a spreadsheet or a notebook where they've been tracking the location of labor protests or the history of sanitation infrastructure, and like we want that stuff to kind of, we want an environment where that stuff can start to mingle and play and be visualized. So that's where we're going next with it. I'm gonna leave it at that. Questions, commentary, other things you wanna jump in. We're also, as this shirt illustrates, we're trying to have fun with this as we go. So this is actually some sort of like data building footprint art that we've like turning to like a possible merch experiment. So our shop sells a lot of nice things, but they're a little like, they're very much centered around like bookish nostalgia and like reading culture, which is great, it's all good. But we're trying to kind of even put some playful products out there that kind of start to tell the story of like, information in this library is part of a long chain of remediations and transformations. And this is sort of like a unapologetically abstract design, but that has a story behind it. This is actually the Hippodrome, this large footprint, which is where Eataly now sits, not far from here in Madison Square. So this is the 100 largest buildings laid out. So I'll leave that at that. But questions, other comments?
Are you guys the entire team or are there
more? We are actually just a subset of our department, believe it or not. So because we expanded to encompass this whole digital library lifecycle, we have close to 30 people on our team. But that represents you know, core production activities, our whole digital imaging unit, our digitization lab, which is out at Long Island City in Queens, our metadata team that Sean leads, our product and R&D group, which is also building some other products for the library, kind of incubating new products, for example, an ebook reader that the library is going to use to lend ebooks in a less painful way, hopefully. And so there's a lot of things going on, a lot of things cooking, and then this kind of engagement team and an administrative kind of team. So it's grown quite large, and we decided that keeping the kind of labs moniker on it, both there was already some name recognition that we wanted to kind of keep that kind of community dialogue going. And in a way, we think all of this stuff is one big experiment. We're having to like rethink and reinvent a lot of things. And so we want to kind of apply that mindset to both the edge projects and the core projects and see them as very interrelated. I think there's a risk when you kind of set up a lab, there's kind of a trend of labs being set up in cultural organizations or newspapers or wherever, and that cool stuff can happen, but it can be too isolated. It can be too kind of cut off from the core operation. And so we're trying, it's an experiment. Our whole organization, our whole unit is an experiment. How do you try to do both at the same time? So. I'm gonna sit down.
Thank you all for sharing this really exciting stuff. I'm curious how you're all thinking about data ownership and like data access. Like you mentioned a little bit about your API access model. How do you guys map that out? And like, how do people who volunteer ask about, well, what's the life cycle of the data and
sure.
the work that I'm putting into it?
Right.
Yeah, totally. I'll take that. So with everything at the library that involves, oh, we got it in a computer, copyright comes first. And for so much of this, we just have a very boilerplate terms of service. You make it on our website, you license it to us, or you make one of these projects. Not the best, but it's acceptable. There's not much nuance to it, but it lets us do participatory work. For all of these projects that we have built, what we've tried to do is be as upfront as possible about what we're using it for now, and then what it could be used for, and kind of gesturing toward that. And then we've had a really good track record of kind of trying to make good on each and every one. Our closest peer in the citizen sciences, who frankly are like the Yankees, one more Staten Island Yankees, is Zooniverse. And Zooniverse. And so these are the folks who came up with Project Galaxy Zoo. They now run about 23, 25 at any time active citizen science projects. They are incredible. They measure their output in terms of there's over a million registered users, 100,000 are active. They've had hundreds of millions, if not billions, of classifications, people doing real scientific work. And again, they put, like a lot of the things that we do, real transparency behind these projects. You're actually working on real science. We're showing you how, here's how you're in touch with the science team. But we've got a slightly different approach to what happens with that data than a lot of the citizen science projects do. For many of these things, they draw from open data repositories to begin with. And for us, it's privileged because no one else has had access to it. And so in many cases, even if it's been out on the web before, no one's had that opportunity to have this thing brought in front of them. And then because so much of this is for the humanities, as opposed to the hard sciences, you might just turn back around and give your data set to a principal investigator. And they're going to publish a paper, and then when they're done, they'll release the data set. For us, we make it a really key thing to release the data set in raw form, as well as much as we can, needs to explore it, because frankly, we can't expect most humanists are going to be able to parse a CSV, query an API, actually have access to the technical skills behind a lot of these things. But we want to make sure that that's absolutely there for everyone who wants it, because that's the way that we would want to do it. As you know, when you're talking to developers, it's actually a fairly sizable group of people who understand a really common set of languages. And it's broadened the access to a lot of different kinds of material. I think about what's happened with geodata. Mapping used to be really hard to learn. Now it's significantly easier because it's spoken in frameworks that a lot of different types of people can understand. So we want that for researchers who are going to come in and work primarily with this as a single new object. But for folks who want better direct access to it, or want to query the data set in a
more obvious way. There's a reason that we build tools like we did for What's on the Menu, where, okay, here's a histogram of what these fluctuations are over time in terms of price, in terms of frequency, in terms of location, in terms of improving access to finding material in the first place. So we try to make sure of that. For a lot of the newer material we're getting, though, anything that's post-1923, anything where we can't be sure that it isn't in the public domain, we're in a real bind. When we collect something new today, for instance, videos at the Library of the Performing Arts, where they're capturing actual Broadway theater performances, you still have to be an accredited researcher. Like, I'm not allowed in that room. None of us on this team probably would be allowed in the room.
You only get like one rewind.
Yes.
So just like very.
It's ridiculous. And these are part of the terms of those agreements upon which we acquire these things. The copyright agreement that we acquire the thing with governs so much of what we're then able to do with it. On the other hand, there's other places like our archives division where we literally bought a shipping container full of Timothy Leary's papers. And in it came a bunch of Timothy Leary's floppy disks, including his SimCity save games, his correspondence from the 80s, unwritten scripts, artwork by Keith Haring for a movie of Neuromancer that never got made. Like, this is insane. And for so much of what we're able to do with that, like, the tools to get at that are only available if you show up on site. And we can't invest in building custom tools for that. So what do? We will, when we acquire a thing, look at what the thing that makes the most sense for it is. And for a lot of those, it's the same tools that cops use for digital forensics. The same stuff that's used for, the same tools that get used, like, if somebody is gonna see, okay, is there child porn on that computer? What is it gonna take to look through every single file and folder and make sense of that? That's not the kind of data that we're able to take outside the library and publish out into the open web. But it's exactly the kind of thing that we know we need to keep doing.
So that brings questions we'd love to hear thoughts about too, like kind of more, and I know Bonnie, you've been like exploring this a lot, like how, or what are some more, from data that cannot be broadly disseminated, what are there research environments that we can create in libraries that, and in a public library, which is really intriguing proposition, to do data-driven research and access sensitive data sets?
Because we've been throwing out this provocation, partially inspired by Duncan Watts from Microsoft Research, what kind of data enclaves. We call it a big data reading room because that'll probably have a better chance of getting funding. But we really want to figure out what does it start to look like to serve data as a library, even if it can only just be on site. What does that start to enable for researchers? What kinds of new things can get done when you can have supported access to things that may be open and may be proprietary in the same place? And how does that really help enable scientific replication of papers? How does that enable folks to come in and do the kinds of work that otherwise you'd have to be docked at a specific company to kind of do? We want to figure out how to make that possible, and that's one of the big paths forward that we see for what Labs can be doing.
Was your question also about like the data that individual contributors produce and who owns
what they input here? I want to add like one like really just way lower level thing, which is that we don't believe factual information can carry that kind of copyright. So like as a group at a department, we're sort of firmly in that vein, and every bit of this that we publish has a statement that says, to the extent that this could have copyright, even though we don't think it does, we dedicate it CC0. So
the building inspector, even though it's very focused on just like one layer of mass, one time period, and the API is giving you access to data that's not even fully cleaned and validated yet, that's CC0, so you'll see that right there.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and as much as we can, different, I mean, building inspector, you can see what you've done, right? Not in menus, you cannot see that it was not built in the system. I mean, you can see what everybody's done, but you don't know what you personally did, right? It's not being kept track of. But in building inspector, if you want, you can like save your progress and see what you've done. In terms of ownership.
Yeah, and that opens up a bigger thing the library's trying to figure out. And one of the reasons we haven't put a lot of emphasis in these projects on One was just like there were experiments, we didn't know if the public could do this, so keep the barrier low. No, don't require a login, don't even have a login option. Building Inspector, we can authenticate through Facebook, Twitter, Google. Maybe we'll add Zooniverse actually as an OAuth kind of that we might add in there, because there's a lot of big users who might cross over. But it's not a library patron account system. The library patron account system is around the more traditional category of like circulating materials requests. And the library's right now trying to figure out a larger kind of single sign-on kind of architecture and to look, re-examine aspects of the privacy policy to allow in a privacy-respecting way, opt-in ways to kind of have some things tracked to provide more personalized service and things like this, or to kind of get more invested in a participatory project where you want to see your progress, see what you contributed, maybe even like attain a higher kind of rank in a way of like more advanced duties, more kind of administrative duties. Something we're definitely thinking about, but it's kind of that architecture, that user framework is really nascent to not really existing in the library.
Yeah, when our group was just getting started, they're like, don't build this thing. You're gonna have sign on in like 3 months. We've been hearing 3 months for the past 3 years. So
yeah, we're still at but getting there. We are getting there.
Just so you guys know, in terms of time, I want to make sure I respect everyone's time. We're gonna wrap it all up around 1:30. So whatever pieces you want to.
Oh wow! Yeah. So we don't. Yeah, we don't need to do like another two chapters. I think we don't have time for that. And they really extend out of this one. I mean, maybe we could put out just kind of some open questions too, just to talk a little bit more. I mean, so as a demonstrator, as we talked about. Our work to date has been heavily anchored around historical materials, and will continue to be a big kind of subset of this. But as we look into like, so where are the next areas of investigation around the idea of like information flows in the city? There's a really great project that was started in our adult ed department around gathering oral histories from different neighborhoods in New York City using the branches as a kind of a hub, and with a really ingenious kind of volunteer-driven model where, where people in the community volunteer to do interviews and to be interviewed, and sometimes they switch roles, and then they kind of spread word of the project and bring others into the orbit of the project. So this has now been happening in a bunch of branches. We piloted about a year ago in Greenwich Village, and our Jefferson Market branch, that big castle building on 6th Avenue. Got an initiative in Harlem, Bronx, Staten Island, and just kicked off in Inwood, Washington Heights. And actually, right next door, the Library of Wine, a more specific community focused one around the stories of the disability experience. And but by and large, these are about neighborhood history, where we're from, history of the neighborhood, your personal experience in the neighborhood, and they're just using Zoom recorders and gathering these. There aren't transcripts. And we've been helping to put these things online and prototyping some crowdsourcing tools to kind of index, extract entities from the audio, identify topics and themes and maybe things that we can structure into more networkable kind of metadata. So we see this as a really exciting, this has almost been a side project for our group, just helping to get a rudimentary website up for them. But we see this as potentially really growing and maybe indicative of a really exciting new model, a new way of thinking of the branches as almost like physically instantiated internet nodes. where the information that matters to a community, in this case, the stories, the history of the neighborhood, can be collected and put online and kind of transmitted out. But we're curious, what other informational needs or data could be aggregated, organized, made more accessible, more usable on that community level. There's this big question about the future of the branch libraries. What is a local library? What should it be in the future? And here's an example of a heavily annotated. I don't know if that's going to work. One other example, I can even pass this around. The library does do a lot of really important like civic data aggregation for its communities in a very old-fashioned way. This is something our adult ed program, they have a subunit that looks at really the incarcerated population.
Serving people who are just recently out of prison. And this is a book that is published every year that basically collects, sort of like a Yelp for the dispossessed. It brings together a lot of information about anything from like quitting smoking hotlines to job searching kind of resources, hunger, kind of, you know, food services, all kinds of things, and they're aggregated in this. So there's a project right there to put that online in some way that's more intuitive. But yeah, what were you gonna pass this around?
From this more historical data collection analysis to more, I guess, real time.
Yeah.
Have you thought much about what happens when there's a real time information sort of exposure about, I don't know, someone tells a story, they tell a story about abuse, or I don't know, a crime that's been committed, or something to that effect? Like, have you thought through?
Yeah, we've had like the luxury of time for most of that. So this. This is something that's happened in library world and primarily in archives for quite some time. So, did you report on the thing at Boston at LJA? You could probably speak to this way better than I. But
it's not a unique story. I think you're talking about, right, that there's an oral history that ended up implicating people in Northern Ireland's IRA bombings, I believe it was, right? And it was the archive's failure to keep that collection closed that ended up exposing the name of some people implicated in serious crimes.
In this case, it wasn't the failure of the archive, it was the inability of the archive to legally protect the original agreement. And so if there is something where no one even knows the thing is being collected, then there's an opportunity for that. But we haven't come across that yet. We haven't had to think about we're collecting and disclosing a thing that maybe may have never been created to real time. This could lead to that, but there's never been that scenario. Usually when we get something, it's particularly if it's got that kind of like, it's the end of a person's life or the end of a corporation's life.
So I think, you know, maybe I suggest sort of just thinking about how, you know, data and vulnerable people who are still vulnerable or alive or that sort of thing, just sort of maybe thinking through what that might look like about, you know, availability and data retention, you know, that type of stuff.
Yeah, I think there's an element too where it's like, it's, you know, obviously we're interested in sort of the edge, or not edge, you know, the implications of a lot of the stuff, but I think another important piece of what Labs is and what it does is it's aligning these two things, but it'll never be unmediated. Like, we believe really strongly that this is seated in the, like, traditional context of what libraries and archives do, and so, like, it's not about, you know, just sort of, okay, adding, collecting everything and saying, like, wait, this is the new library's collections. Like, there's still kind of that mix. I mean, I think Building Inspector, the geo stuff, is a great mix of that, where it's sort of saying, like, all right, we did a lot of the classic library work to digitize this and get some great metadata around it, and now here you're sort of adding this additional element. But, I mean, it doesn't completely head off those, but it mitigates, I think, a lot of those pieces.
And it's prompting me to, when we next talk with our Alex Kelly, who's our brilliant colleague in Belded, who runs this program, he used to work at StoryCorps and has been applying and adapting some of those models. I know there is like kind of a volunteer guideline sheet. I wonder if that's in there at all. There may be something about sensitive topics.
These are reviewed. I mean, like, these don't go immediately online. Like, these go through that sort of library, you know, but they're not.
But if I understand the in the model, it's probably on the interviewer, who's also a community volunteer, to do that. Maybe, you know, oh, something came up here that was, you know, it's interesting, sensitive. So that's really, really important, and I think valuable.
From a copyright standpoint, sometimes we talk about, and some places have actually built dark archives. So places will not necessarily talk about the acquisition of the material. And it is only available to either system administrators, or it's encrypted by a time-bound encryption mechanism so that you can't actually get to it for a certain time period. And so it might be possible to collect a lot of the stuff, just not allow it out.
I might be the only one losing sleep over this. I mean, I share your concerns. You know, a certain combination of data sources. You know, you can identify our own thing. Mm-hmm. And you know, I've worked at jobs where we have instances where patrons have come to us and said, "Hey, you digitized our school newspaper from the 1990s. I'm trying to get a job. There's my name saying, you know, I was arrested for public tax." You know, that sort of thing, where it's like, it's public information, but you know, in digitizing it in, you know, the unstructured data out there on the web, you know, we are really making it more visible on the paper which we intended to be. And so, I mean, I definitely think we need to look more at how we, it's tricky because it's like the options right now are like dark archive, or you just put a
Yeah, it's and it's interesting to have these experiments. And this one, again, initiated not even by our group, but by a very enterprising staff member in the adult ed department. But sometimes these, you know, we kind of like sensed it, like, oh, this feels like, you know, a project we'd like to help kind of get moving. But they're often moving a little ahead of where the library is, or maybe even where we've totally thought through implications. You know, where the reformulation of our privacy policy has really actually slowed down a lot of development of support systems, patron-facing systems, the catalog, all kinds of stuff. We found these kind of, you know, these kind of more gray zones to kind of try experiments. But yeah, they do move ahead. They do provoke. They're valuable. They provoke those questions. But we need to then really look at what we're doing. Yeah. Wondering in the time that remains, if there's other. Just love to hear other things percolating in your minds. Not even specific questions about this or responses to this, but just, you know, the whole question of the public library in this time we're in and the time we're heading into, and in light of the work you do and the types of work and research you do. Or just anything. Here's what's like kind of running through your minds about thoughts.
I'm trying to figure out how the big data reading room is going to work. So I did my big data reading room pass, and I go and I'm able to access these data sets in a more raw form. I guess that's a relative term than the curated public facing thing. And I use this time in the reading room to inform some piece of work. And what's the trail? How do I cite, and how do others, you talk about reproducibility, how do others then come along and
sure.
Verify my work?
So for folks who want to do a lot of contemporary work on top of, say, Facebook or LinkedIn or really, really large-scale corporate proprietary data sets today, oftentimes they'll actually have to become an employee at the corporation in order to do that research. They get a laptop from the company, and as an employee, the company has the right to review anything that they publish. They've got to consider whether allowing that person in the first place is something they want to do, not only in terms of like, do we want to advance research, but something that we want to administer, something that we want to spend our time, money, HR budget to allow this person to do this. This person can cost us money. And so for someone on the outside, the opportunity to come in, see what was published, and get access to that material is next to nothing in the future. And so there isn't that ability to go back in and do this again. There are models like this. So there's, if you want access to raw census data before the popular disclosure, 70 years from the time of census collection, Census Bureau operates a research center where you can go and actually get that for certain types of credit projects. And you can go back in, and other folks can go and do that same kind of work. The model is known as a data enclave. What hasn't been done, though, is the ability to bring together the kinds of really massive scale data sets that are only administered by individual companies today into a single place and allow people to, one, work across these things, but two, have access to them in a way that others can actually be guaranteed that same level of access, that same level of admissions, permissions. And so part of it would mean creating an entity like the New York Public Library or some other organization that could do a lot of that vetting, that could, we'll take care of the overhead, we'll make sure that it conforms to your general terms that have been set out in the gift of access to this material, but you as a company aren't gonna have to deal with that, as well as allowing these researchers to actually bring these data sets together in a way that is never really potentially pushing a lot of social science advances that we haven't been able to see or work with in a long time. The reason we talk... Part of the reason that we really want to do this is because, frankly, we've got really world-class research institutions here in New York, but if you want to work with this kind of material, you either have to be a really expensive PI at one of those places, bring in a ton of grant money to do it, convince a lot of people to make this happen, and it's not available through the library, it's not available to other kinds of researchers, it's locked to your lab. It's not something that allows other researchers beyond yourself, frankly, access to it. So if we can do this in a way that it's thought of as a new service of a public research library, where any member of the public can apply through certain levels of accreditation to certain types of data sets and still get supported access to any kind of public data set that the library has managed to acquire. Things like being able to compute across ProQuest, which currently costs a massive subscription fee, access to the Twitter FireEye. Again, things that are sold, but you can start to subsidize. It starts to bring together some resources in some really interesting, really provocative ways. We don't know exactly how to service that infrastructure.
And to be very clear, this is like a very blue sky idea.
Yeah.
This is not like libraries.
We're
not going to
see an announcement next week.
we wanted to kind of put it out there further out, kind of like an implication. I mean, again, and there may be historically, you know, data sets mined from historical materials that would be in that context, but I think what we're showing with these is like, let's work on sort of public domain stuff, put it out there, even send some signals of vitality and new thinking from the library, just period. And like, this is happening. We're looking at our collections in a new way. But yeah, I think it's the idea, yeah, as Dave said, it's more around this kind of extending that tradition of subsidized access that we do provide, I mean, great scale and even to purely electronic resources, but not for computational or kind of data-driven interrogation. And you see in more proximate to the existing notion of libraries, yeah, like things like there have been some interesting examples of digital humanities scholars and librarians kind of negotiating a special kind of arrangement with a ProQuest or kind of a journal, an electronic journal provider to allow some kind of large like text mining. The HathiTrust, which is sort of the public mirror of Google Books that is administered by the University of Michigan and a network of research libraries that we're a part of. Only about a third of that corpus is public domain. They have set up what they call the HathiTrust Research Center, which allows for kind of large-scale text analysis of the entire corpus without actual access to the full texts. And that's done through kind of virtual machines, and Internet Archive is experimenting with that too, around their TV News Archive. Mm-hmm. And so you see some of the glimmers of this that are really interesting, a little more proximate to types of resources libraries traditionally provided, but then you get into these questions of like social data sets and corporate data sets. I mean, so it's a really like big
part of it is also that we really want to light a fire under today's libraries to start collecting in a way that they haven't in a really long time. We thought of collecting in a very regimented way, at least in the New York Public Library in terms of specific collections. And then what's even more kind of disconcerting to me is that in some places, the way that we buy for certain general collections is we feed a collections budget into a system and it will feed back, okay, these are probably the books you're going to want to buy from all the publishers that are out this year. That human curation element isn't driving all of those purchasing decisions anymore, and that's kind of scary, as well as trying to spur the collection of new materials. So when the Library of Congress got a copy of the Twitter archive, they haven't been able to do anything with it, frankly. They've been able to get it on tape. There's never been able to be an analysis done of this material at the Library of Congress, because somebody testified on the Hill that, oh, we're not going to need any extra help for that. We don't need any extra funding. We don't need private or public funding to help make this thing happen. And so this has just been sitting on tape. So if that goes there at presumably the greatest library in the United States, one of the greatest research libraries in the world, and it can't be used, someone else has to try to nudge folks in the right direction.
So. Sobering thought, we may be at our time.
We're at 1:30. But if folks have other things they want to ask, we can be there a little longer for more discussion if anyone would like to talk.
Great to have been here. Thanks for coming.
Thank you so much.